الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، أشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد،
very pleased to come here today. This is my first trip to England since I was about 3 years old, so I don't remember too much from that time. But let me just, before I begin my talk, I noticed on the flyer there's something about a leading authority of Qatar in the USA. And this is a thing which I think we picked up from the Kufar and their advertising packages. And we should be honest, and not try to exaggerate or give some false impression of anyone. Inshallah, if the person's worth listening to, then whatever he is should be sufficient. If he's not worth listening to, then no matter what slogan you give him, no matter what name you give him, he still will not be worth listening to. Inshallah. In the time that we have actually picked a very big topic about the اختلاف الفقهاء, or the reasons for the different opinions among the fuqaha or the jurists, and how do we approach or how do we deal with those different opinions. Well, obviously in this hour we're not really going to be able to complete much, and I think it might be best if I try to limit the time that I speak and allow you to ask as many questions as you can, because then, you know, in questions I might speak about something not necessarily that relevant, while questions are usually from the audience, they are things that are relevant, that are necessary for the brothers here. As I said, this topic, أسباب اختلاف الفقهاء, it is a topic that many books have been written about it. Some of those books are about 600 pages long, so obviously we're not going to be covering even just a small amount of the topic. However, let me begin by mentioning a hadith, or a famous hadith, and this is a hadith that says اختلاف أمتي رحمة, that the difference of opinion among my ummah is a mercy. And I mentioned that hadith at the outset in this lecture to first of all mention that that is not an authentic hadith. It's not a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. And when we find differences of opinion, we shouldn't look at the difference of opinion and say, well, difference of opinion is a mercy, and so therefore let's just accept whatever opinion there might be, as I'll talk about at the end of how to approach different opinions. But instead, we should realize that we're always seeking and looking for the truth, inshallah, and the correct way to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And many of you may have grown up as Muslims, some of you may have converted to Islam, and I think all of us, inshallah, all of us are Muslims. We have either come to Islam or we have remained as Muslims because we want to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala correctly and we want to follow the truth. So that's also related to the case where there's different opinion among the scholars, inshallah, as I will mention later. Now, I have divided the different opinion among the scholars into four types, and this is my own. And after reading many books on this topic, I have come up with this division. So you may ignore it if you wish, or inshallah you might benefit from it. I have divided into what I call practical causes or practical reasons that have led to different opinions, and then theoretical, and then differences of understanding, and then problematic issues that have led to differences of opinion. Inshallah, I think as we discuss some of them, they will become clear as to what exactly I mean by that. Let us start with the practical differences, because they are the most obvious, easiest to understand, and in essence they are also the easiest to deal with. The practical differences, what I mean by that, for example, is that when a scholar, and by the way, these are different opinions, and even if the scholar is as sincere as possible and uses all of his effort to come to the truth, these causes may still exist, may still cause some differences to exist even among scholars who are as sincere as possible, who are not willing or are not trying to swerve or deviate from the straight path. So when you put a question to a scholar, or when a scholar has to make a decision about a certain issue, sometimes there is a hadith about that issue. Now, some of these things are related to hadith in particular, because the nature of the hadith, the body of hadith, for example, is different from the Quran. So therefore, many times, as I said, we'll be talking about hadith, but sometimes even they are even related to Quran. So when you ask a scholar a question, if there is a particular hadith about that issue, and this scholar is not familiar with that hadith, because the body of hadith literature is quite large. Even some Sahaba, the Sahaba did not spend all of their time with the Prophet Muhammad. They had their families to take care of, they had their livelihoods to maintain. Some, like Abu Huraira, spent all of his time with the Prophet, except of course when he was with his wife, because he devoted himself to that, he lived in the mosque and so forth. So even among the Sahaba, you can find this case where an issue comes up, a question comes up that requires an answer, that requires a solution, and there actually exists a hadith about that particular issue. However, the person who is being asked, or the person who has to give the answer to that issue, he himself may not be familiar with that hadith. So, what does he do? Well, if it's a question that needs an answer that time, of course, he will do some research. For example, nowadays, unless it's something oral like this, most people have the ability, if I receive a question, I have the ability to go, or the time to go and search for it. Suppose I search for the answer, and there's a hadith existing, but I still don't find the hadith. Well, let's not drag me into this, okay? Let's drag a mujtahid, okay? So the mujtahid doesn't find the answer. However, the answer is needed. So what does he do? Abu Bakr, for example, during the time of Abu Bakr, a woman came to him, a grandmother, and asked what is her share in the inheritance. And he said, I find in the Book of Allah no share for you in the inheritance in her particular case. Umar ibn al-Khattab, for example, did not know about the whether or not the hadith, they did not know about the hadith concerning whether or not Magians or Majus should pay the jizya or not. However, these are decisions or things that need to be decided. So the mujtahid has to make ijtihad. Since he doesn't know the hadith, obviously if he knows the hadith, if Abu Bakr knew that the Prophet ﷺ gave the grandmother 1/6, then obviously he'll say the Prophet ﷺ gave 1/6, you have 1/6. If Umar knew the hadith about treat the maidens like you treat the Ahlul Kitab, he would have made them pay jizya. So they have to, in that case, the mujtahid has to make ijtihad. When he makes ijtihad, one of two things happens. Either his ijtihad is consistent with the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that he didn't know about, or it goes against the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. One time Ibn Mas'ud was once asked about what is the situation of a woman who got married. However, the mahr was not declared or stated, because the mahr is not from the arkan of the zawaj. And you can get married and you can state the mahr later. So he said, what is the situation of the woman who gets married? And the question was put to him, what is the situation of the woman who gets married and her mahr has not been stated? Okay. and her husband dies before they get a chance to decide what is the matter. So Ibn Mas'ud, Sahabi, he didn't know of any hadith of the Prophet about this, so he had to make ijtihad. So he said that her mahar should be the mahar of the women who are similar to her. And in other words, if there's some women who are similar to her, like her sisters, whatever, and they got a certain mahar, then she should get the same mahar from the, you know, from the inheritance of the. I mean, it comes out first from the husband's wealth before inheritance. So one person said that this ijtihad, Abdullah bin Mas'ud, said, is the same conclusion or the same judgment that he heard the Prophet ﷺ make in a similar case. Abdullah bin Mas'ud said that was the happiest day of his life. And that he was able to make ijtihad, and he knew for certain that that ijtihad was correct and consistent with the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. So in the case where the scholar makes ijtihad, and his ijtihad is in accordance with the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, that we find that out later, or we discover that, alhamdulillah, that's pretty simple. But what about the cases where a scholar makes ijtihad in that case, and the ijtihad he makes may go against the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ? Abu Huraira, for example, used to have the opinion that if you wake up by Fajr time during the month of Ramadan, and you are in the state of janaba, you need to make ghusl, you have to make ghusl, and you wake up after the time Fajr already begins, he said in that case you do not fast yet. And in other words, he's saying it's a requirement that you make ghusl before Fajr time. That was his ijtihad, because he did not know about the sunnah or the practice of the Prophet with respect to that. So some people took this fatwa, actually it wasn't even his fatwa, he got the fatwa from another one of the Sahaba. But in any case, they took his fatwa, they took that statement, and they went to some of the wives of the Prophet Muhammad and mentioned that to them, and they said, no. Sometimes we would get up with the Prophet and we would not have ghusl, and we would make ghusl at Fajr time and fast that day. So here we have the case where we find out the hadith, and the hadith contradicts what the scholar says. So they went back to Abu Huraira and they informed Abu Huraira about that situation, and immediately, what did he do? He changed his opinion. And he went according, of course, to the hadith of the Prophet. I mean, you have no choice in that matter, right? You have to follow the hadith of the Prophet, the sunnah of the Prophet. You cannot use your mind or your own ijtihad and make some conclusion and find it goes against the hadith of the Prophet, but you say, well, that's okay, I'm still going to follow my ijtihad. And we learn that from the Sahaba, from Abu Bakr, and the example I gave earlier, from Umar ibn Khattab, from Abu Huraira. We find that this is the case, that if you make ijtihad, or if someone makes ijtihad, and his ijtihad is wrong, and he has shown that it is wrong, that it goes against, for example, hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, then he has to change his opinion, and he has to follow the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Now, was that mujtahid? Was he sinful in what he did? No, he wasn't sinful. In fact, opposite, he would, inshallah, get ajr. And if he was sincere and he was trying to follow the truth, and he wanted to follow the truth, then even if he was wrong, he would get ajr. Because the Prophet ﷺ said that if a hakim or if a judge decides something, and he exercises his judgment to decide something, and he is wrong, or if he's right, he will get two rewards. If he is wrong, he'll get the reward of using his effort to find which was the truth. So that means that, for example, in this case, and I'm kind of taking this one case and giving other principles related to it because of the time. According to my watch, it's already 9:30, but that's Colorado time, so don't worry about that. Actually, it is 7. That's 9:30 this morning, so I guess we still have quite a bit of time before 5 o'clock. So from this, from these incidences, from this situation, and from this hadith of the Prophet, we can see some important principles that we should keep in mind when dealing with differences of opinion among the scholars. Number one, if the scholar makes a mistake that is not a blemish on his scholarship, that is not a blemish on his piety, Abu Bakr made ijtihad which is wrong. Umar made ijtihad which is wrong. Abu Huraira was following an opinion which is wrong. Not only is it not a blemish on their character or on their scholarship, but if we have no reason to doubt their intention, we have to believe that inshallah they will be rewarded for what they did. And that's not just true with respect to Abu Bakr and Umar and so forth, but that is true for all the scholars who came after them, that we have no reason to believe that they have some wrong intention in what they're doing, like Imam Malik, Abu Hanifa, Shafi'i, well, Ahmad. I always try to state them in chronological order so nobody thinks I'm... If anybody asks me, why did you say it that way, I'll just say that's the chronological order. I could give it alphabetical order, but I give it the chronological order. And they made mistakes in their ijtihadat or in their ijtihad. And if we see an obvious mistake, then in other words, they made an ijtihad which goes against a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, then our approach to that is that in this case he was wrong, we have to follow the Prophet ﷺ, and may Allah reward this mujtahid for his efforts. So that does not change his status at all. Unfortunately, sometimes when you say that, when you say, for example, oh, Imam Ash-Shafi was wrong on that point, and people get the impression sometimes that you are attacking Imam Ash-Shafi. How can you say that Imam Ash-Shafi was wrong? If it's a case like this, this is one of the cases. Again, this is one of the cases of difference of opinion among the scholars. If it's a case like this, where you have a clear hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and you have, for example, Imam Ash-Shafi's statement that goes against the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, then either the hadith is wrong or Imam Ash-Shafi is wrong. It is the best thing to assume. The best thing to assume is that Imam Ash-Shafi did not know this hadith. There's other good things you can assume, but this is one of the best things that you can assume. So you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward him for his efforts, but on this point he was wrong. Is he still a scholar? Is he still an imam? Sure, of course. I mean, have you ever been in a course where you make one mistake and you get an F? I hope not. I mean, I heard the schools are tougher here in England than in the States, but I hope, I mean, not to that extent. And if that were the case, you know, then every one of us, then we should consider ourselves F in Deen or F in everything, because I'm sure every one of us makes mistakes every now and then. So that should be our attitude with respect to recognizing, for example, a case like this. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward the mujtahid, and at the same time we follow the correct hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In fact, all of these a'immah of the Ahl al-Sunnah wa Jama'ah throughout the history, all of them showed it. I mean, this is what they taught us. This is what they taught us. That if there's a hadith which is authentic, that goes against something that they have said, then just ignore what they have said and follow the authentic hadith. Because in the Quran we are obliged, absolute obedience to Allah and His Messenger. Nobody else. Not to Abu Bakr, not to Umar, not to Imam Abu Hanifa, not to Imam Ash-Shafi, not to Ibn Taymiyyah, not to anyone today. We are obliged to have absolute obedience to Allah and His Messenger. And if anyone says anything that goes in contrary to what these messengers said, to what the messenger said, either while conveying the Quran or through his Sunnah, then we have to politely reject what they said and follow the hadith or the truth coming from the Prophet. Some people go off into other things and say, oh well, my imam, whatever that might be, must have known that hadith. For example, Imam Shafi must have known that hadith, but he didn't apply it for some reason, or he rejected it for some reason, and so forth. Well, that's possible, but from the point of view of principle, what principle should we apply here? It is much safer and much more correct from the point of view of the text of the Quran and Sunnah for you to assume first, for example, that Imam Shafi didn't know that hadith and follow the hadith correctly, and follow the hadith, and then you may study why did Imam Shafi differ from you. And if you find, oh, he has some proof that hadith was abrogated, for example, or something of that nature, then you follow Imam Shafi's opinion and you don't follow the hadith. if he has some proof that you're not supposed to go to him. In other words, al-asl, or the basic position, the first position is follow the hadith, if it's authentic, follow the hadith. Then, but if you're still worried about why did Imam Shafi have a different opinion, instead of saying, no, Imam Shafi must have known that hadith and he must not have followed it for some reason, you are making an assumption there, and you are making a big assumption, and based on that assumption, you are following Imam Shafi rather than following a hadith of the Prophet. This is a mistake. You have no proof for what you said, you just made that assumption, that, oh, he must have known that hadith. No one, as Imam Shafi himself wrote, about the Arabic language and about the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. No one knows all of the Arabic language, although if you take all the Arabs together, they know the Arabic language. And no one knows all, no one person knows all the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. That's Imam Shafi'i himself saying this. So instead of making this assumption, that you rather follow Imam Shafi'i and assume that he must have known the hadith and he must have some reason to not to follow it, you follow the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. And if you want to study it and discover why Imam Shafi'i didn't follow it, then you might find, yes, he has some evidence not to follow it, that he knew the hadith and so forth. And I can give you some examples of that if I remember to, inshallah. Sometimes, the person knows the hadith. However, in his opinion, he feels that the hadith is not authentic. So if the hadith is not authentic, it is actually not, you cannot look at it as an evidence. So in that case, if the hadith is not authentic, then he will ignore it as an evidence and he will make ijtihad again. Based on other evidence. And if, for example, he might know another Quranic verse which is somewhat related to the question, or he might know another hadith which is somewhat related to the question. So instead of following this hadith, which is not authentic in his opinion, he uses those other two evidences and he derives the conclusion from that evidence. Okay. However, that hadith might be authentic. Maybe the way that he himself heard that hadith, for example, especially in the early years, you could have, let's leave this, I guess, for now right here. No, that's not. You could have, especially in the early years, for example, you could have the one hadith that reaches, let's say, Imam Malik through an authentic chain. And he knows that this hadith is authentic. However, that same hadith reaches, for example, Abu Hanifa through a weak chain. So he studies it and he looks, he said, well, this hadith is not authentic. So he ignores it and he makes the ijtihad based on other evidence. Well, Imam Malik knows, because of the different chain that he had, the different way that he received that hadith, he knows that hadith is authentic, so he bases his opinion on that hadith. So you have the hadith, you have the opinion of Imam Malik, which follows the hadith. You have the opinion of Abu Hanifa, which goes against that hadith, because the way he received it, it was not an authentic hadith. Now, I'll give you an example from Imam Shafi'i. In the Shafi'i madhab, most of the Shafi'i scholars, especially those who perhaps do not have that strong of a background in hadith, most of the Shafi'i scholars are of the opinion that if you touch a woman, okay, وَلَمَسْتُمْ النِّسَاء, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes in the Quran, وَلَمَسْتُمْ النِّسَاء, this means talking about making wudu or purifying yourself before the prayer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions if you touch women. Now here, the touch here, I mean, you cannot really, you know, in English we do not have a structure where sometimes the word in Arabic tells you that two people are involved, or it's an intensive word, meaning that stressing the action itself and so forth. We cannot really translate those into English. However, you could understand this verse to mean touch, as in touch. Okay. So in the Shafi'i madhhab, any touch between a man and a woman, any woman, you have to make wudu before prayer. Okay, this invalidates your wudu. Okay. So Imam Shafi'i derived that from this word from the Quran. That was the evidence that he had. However, However, at the same time though, he knew the hadith of Aisha, in which it states that the Prophet ﷺ would kiss her sometimes, or actually she said he used to kiss some of his wives, and they said, it must be used. So they have the hadith of Aisha in which she says that the Prophet ﷺ would kiss some of his wives, بعد النساء can also be meaning in just one of them, one or some of his wives, and then go and pray without making wudu. Okay? That goes against the Shafi'i madhhab, but this is a perfect example of the kind of thing that I was talking about. It's an authentic hadith, actually, according to most of the hadithing. It is an authentic hadith. But it reached, the way it reached Imam Shafi, he was not convinced that this is an authentic hadith. However, after stating this, after stating his conclusion, that any touch of a woman, you have to make wudu, he said, however, if the hadith of Aisha is authentic, then that's my matter. So here we know that he knew this hadith, and we know that he did not think it authentic. But he stated clearly that this, if this hadith is authentic, then in other words, my madhab is not if you touch any woman you have to make wudu, but my madhab is what this. So there we have that case where actually the scholar knows the hadith, but because of the way it reached him, he doesn't think the hadith is authentic, while in fact the scholars of hadith or other scholars know that it is authentic. So therefore he ignores it as an evidence, and he follows any other evidences that he has to make ijtihad, and again, his ijtihad may be incorrect. You go against what other scholars say. Here's another case where it is fairly simple, well, fairly simple for those of you who are into hadith, to be able to go and see what do the ulama of hadith say about it. Because like any specialty, you know, if you you know, if your teeth are hurting, for example, you probably don't go to a gynecologist to ask him, you know, what's the problem with my teeth, right? And you go to the specialist in that field. And you trust the decision. I mean, even if you go to a general practitioner, excuse me, if you don't, you cannot always trust the conclusion of the general practitioner, right? Or he may not always be able to help you, they'll have to send you to a specialist. Well, similar with respect to hadith, and if you want to know if a hadith is authentic or not, you should go to those people who are specialized in hadith. Unfortunately, not every faqih is a muhaddith. Not every muhaddith is a faqih, but we're talking about fiqh today. So. Not every person who writes and deals and studies with fiqh is specialized or really is deep into hadith. And that's why you'll find in many of the books of fiqh, historically speaking, you'll find many weak and even sometimes fabricated hadith in the books of fiqh. So they might reject a hadith which is authentic in their books and say, well, this is the hadith that, for example, Imam Shafi or Imam Malik didn't accept it, or Abu Hanifa didn't accept it, so therefore we're just going to ignore it and make ijtihad. So here you go to the scholars of hadith, if they say this hadith is authentic, again, it's, you know, I'm starting with the easy cases. I'm hoping maybe we'll take up all the time with the easy cases. I don't have to worry about the more difficult cases. Again, in that case, you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward the mujtahid for what he did, but you follow the truth, you follow what is correct. A slightly different case, and perhaps this is a little bit more difficult, because now we're again getting a little bit deeper into the area of ulama al-hadith or the science of the hadith. And this is wherein now we take the same hadith, okay, with the same chain, for example, the same source. Remember last time I said we have Malik and Abu Hanifa, and each one got the hadith through a different way. So he got it through an authentic way, he got it through a weak way, so he rejected it and he accepted it. What's a little bit more difficult is where you find the same one hadith, the same chain, and two scholars disagree about whether that one hadith is authentic or not. You understand the differences between the two. So now we're talking about the same, basically the same data, to use modern terms. We have the same data. In the first case, the two people had different data, so they ended up with different conclusions about the hadith. But now we have one data and one examines it and he concludes it's authentic and the other one concludes that it is not authentic. That's a much more difficult case because here, and you have to now really, here you really have to refer to the specialists of hadith for them to determine which one of these two arguments is correct and so forth. And even then, sometimes the scholars of hadith themselves might differ. There's one case, it's a rare case, alhamdulillah, I mean, it's not a common case, but there's one case I can give you in which at least one scholar said the same hadith, about the same hadith, that it's fabricated. Somebody else said it's weak, somebody else said it's hasan, and somebody else said it's sahih. And they're all well-known scholars of hadith. Okay, but as I said, alhamdulillah, as a rare case, usually the scholars of hadith, throughout history, the leading scholars of hadith are well-known, and usually, alhamdulillah, they pretty much agree upon what is the conclusion concerning that hadith. So these are some of the practical reasons. For example, hadith scholar didn't hear the hadith, he didn't know about hadith, or he didn't receive it through authentic means and so forth. So therefore, he has to make ijtihad. Inshallah, when he makes ijtihad, even if he's mistaken, inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward him. But it's our obligation to, so to speak, neglect his opinion when it is wrong and follow the hadith or the way of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now there's other aspects that are related to, I guess, practical differences, but I want to discuss some of the other. We have until 5 o'clock?
4 to 5.
And I said I will leave you plenty of time for questions, didn't I? Okay. We'll see about this. I may have changed my mind. Another area, and this is a much, now this is really the first area that we discussed is relatively simple, relatively easy, and anyone in most cases can really find what is the correct approach. In this case, is this hadith authentic or not? You go to the scholar of the hadith and you can find out, inshallah, if the hadith is authentic or not. However, we have another set of reasons for difference of opinion among the scholars, and this set is much more difficult because this is really based it's based on a science. This is the science of usul al-fiqh, or the what I call Islamic legal theory. I call it Islamic legal theory because it seems nobody applies it, so it's a theory. But this is usul al-fiqh. Now in the case of usul al-fiqh, we have, as I said, a completely different situation in that now the methodology that is being used is different. And because the methodology is being used is different, I mean, when you talk about the four madhahab, for example, the four well-known madhahab, when we talk about four different schools of fiqh, we're really talking about four different schools of usul al-fiqh, or four different methodology or approaches to fiqh. And actually, this is not a lecture on usul al-fiqh, but actually even among those four, if we wanted to break it down a little bit more, we really have two major schools or major approaches, the approach of what are known as the jurists and the approach of the mutakallimun. What we have here now is a difference in the methodology of how to derive Islamic law. And this is really the topic where large books have been written about this topic and so forth. I'll just give a couple of examples, and sometimes I'm trying to pick those examples that I will have to explain as little as possible. Alright, I don't see any that need virtually no explanation. Let's take an example here. Okay, you can tell me if I'm doing something completely wrong here. This is a question of umum. It's called umum al muqtada. Okay, umum al muqtada. This is a case where in the Arabic language, sometimes
a word or some portion of the sentence is not stated. However, it can be understood, or it is implied, or you know that it is implied. However, sometimes the extent or what exactly is implied, sometimes there's a difference between. Okay, I'll give you an example from the Quran. Allah Subhanahu wa Taala says about those who are fasting. ومن كان مريضا أو على سفر. Allah Subhanahu wa Taala says that those who are sick, who are ill, or who are traveling, what does Allah Subhanahu wa Taala say about them? Allah Subhanahu wa Taala says that the one who is sick or who is traveling, he has to fast the same number of days, other days. In other words, while traveling or sick during Ramadan, you don't have to fast, right? Alright. Now, no one except for a school of fiqh, which is called the Bahri Madhab, no one applies that verse in the way that it is stated. In other words, there is something not stated in the verse, however it is understood. It is understood sometimes through linguistic means, sometimes because of other evidences and so forth. Because the verse literally says that whoever is sick or traveling, then he has to fast the same number of other days. What does that mean? Have any of you ever been sick during Ramadan? Yeah, okay. I mean, you don't, if you were all like 12, 13 years old, I could imagine no is the answer to that. Okay, did you ever fast while sick during Ramadan?
Yes, I did.
Okay, so you fasted while you were sick during Ramadan. Did you make up those days again later? Okay, why? Because we know through other evidences that what this verse means is that there's something that isn't stated actually in the verse, but we know that that's the meaning. Okay, the verse's meaning is whoever is muridan or ala suffering, fa'aftara, and he breaks his fast, then he must fast the same number of days there. Okay, they said there's only one school of fiqh, which is the Dhahiri Madhab, which we will not worry about, that says, no, if you are traveling or you're sick and you still fast, that doesn't matter, you have to make up those days there. But we know from other evidence, as I said, that the meaning of this verse is that if you are traveling or you're sick, and this is the part that isn't mentioned, and you break your fast, then you have to make it up on other days. So this is this missing portion, or not stated portion. I was saying missing one time in a lecture one time, and someone got so upset. You know, what do you mean it's missing? Okay, it's not stated. This is not stated portion. This is known as al-muqtada. Okay. Now the question is, sometimes, like in this case, the muqtada or the non-stated portion is very clear, and all the scholars agree that this is the meaning. You won't worry about the five minutes. I said three or four times. Okay, that's a clear case. What about the case in which Allah Subhanahu wa Taala, in which the Prophet Sallallahu has stated? Again, I'm going to give you now the literal meaning of what he has stated. Okay, that Allah has removed, and in other words, this will not be present among this ummah. Allah has removed from this ummah mistake, and actions done out of mistake, forgetfulness, or compulsion. This hadith of the Prophet, it's an authentic hadith. What does it mean? Does it mean what he said? Does it mean just the word that he said, or is there a muqtada, which is a very common thing in the Arabic language? Is there something that he did not state? Well, it's clear, and everyone agrees, that there's something not stated here. Because what the hadith literally states is that you will not find people making mistakes, you will not find people doing things out of forgetfulness, and you will not find people having to do things out of compulsion. But we know that that's the case.
We know that we, I mean, I've done things that are pretty different, I mean, related to, for example, Salat, said the Sahu, sometimes you make a mistake. You forget something in the Salat, right? So these things exist in the Ummah, these things exist. So that obviously is not what the Prophet ﷺ meant. Instead, Allah has removed something related to those things. Now, he has removed something in relation to those things. What? If you are, if you make a mistake, are you a sinner? Are you a sinner? Okay, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has removed the sin of that thing, right? So that in the hereafter, if you do something by mistake or out of forgetfulness or under compulsion, you are not considered a sinner, and in the hereafter you will not be a sinner. But could it imply something else? See, now there are some who say that if there's a muftada or if there's a non-stated portion, then the thing that you assume about its meaning is the minimum possible. What else could there be besides sin in this hadith? Sin has to do with the other world, right? The hereafter. So what about this world? What about the hukum or the ruling of the thing? Okay? So here the muqtada, some scholars will say the muqtada is just the sin. Okay, Allah has removed the sin of these actions. Okay, let's say no. The muqtada is the sin and the hukum. And they will bring evidence from other hadith and so forth to show that the Prophet ﷺ has shown that when you make a mistake or if you do something out of forgetfulness, also the ruling of that thing has been removed. I'll give you an example where these two schools now differ, these two approaches to this question. Is there generality, or can you assume more than one thing with respect to the muqtada, or it has to be the minimum possible? Okay, this is a theoretical difference, right? Right? You take a verse in the Quran or you take a hadith from which there's a muqtada or something not stated. This is a theoretical difference about how to deal with that. And each school has their evidences for why you either generalize it or you don't generalize it. Okay, now this is not a class on Usul al-Dhab, so we'll not go into the evidences for both. So suppose you're praying, alright? So you're in prayer, and someone comes in and says, Assalamu alaikum, and you forget you're in prayer for a second, or out of mistake thinking it's okay, because it used to be okay, you remember those hadiths that used to be okay, and you forget those hadiths in which it's been abrogated, you say, Assalamu alaikum back. Okay? Have you now invalidated your prayer? And is the salat now what? Yes? How many say yes? You've invalidated your prayer. Let's see what another of you people call me. Okay? Alright? How many say no, you haven't invalidated your prayer? How many of you weren't praying in the first place, apparently? A lot of people didn't raise their hand in either yes or no. This is Jaber Sheikh Idris when he first came to England many, many years ago, studying, I think, in the University of London for his PhD in philosophy. He said one time they had a debate between a priest and an atheist about the existence of God. After the debate, they took a vote from the audience. Which one do they agree with? Do you agree with the priest? Yes, God exists. Do you agree with the atheist? He doesn't exist. Sheikh Jaber abstained. He's the only one who abstained. Everybody else said, yes, I believe, I don't believe. He said, what do you mean you abstained? He said, yes. He said, I don't agree with him that there's no God, but I don't believe in this man's God. And so here, I don't know what the abstention here means. But it's part of the answer to this question depends on how do you deal with this problem of umm al-muqtada? If you say that the hukum, the ruling, and the sin is removed, then the person has not invalidated his prayer. Because Allah has removed the ruling and the sin of things that you do out of forgetfulness or
a mistake. If, however, you say, no, just the sin has been removed, the ruling remains, that means now you have invalidated your prayer. So because of the different approaches to this one question, you will come up with different... you will come up with different conclusions. So, as I said at the beginning, this is a very large topic, and we begin very late to give the Sheikh Abdulaziz a chance to give you a lecture, which is probably more important than this lecture. So I'm going to have to stop now, so we do have some time for question and answer before we, I think we have another program later today, or soon today. So I will not even try to give you the meaning, what do I mean by the other two groups. If you come, let's say, late for the prayer, or you don't have to be late, actually. The first line is full, and you come and you're the only one in the second line. If you pray in that situation where you're the only one in the second line, is your prayer invalid as the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ states? Yes, there is a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that says that the one who prays by himself and wrote by himself, his prayer is not valid, or he must repeat the prayer. So many people have different views of how to understand this hadith, and in fact that's the third category dealing with understanding. So if you come now to the roll, to the line, and the roll is full and they're already in prayer, what do you do? Some people say you tap someone, pull them back and so forth. But this is not confirmed from the Sahaba or Tabi'in or anything. They used to do this kind of thing, you tap someone and pull them back. Allah Alam, it seems that the strongest opinion, like other aspects of the Salat, and if you cannot, for example, join the Imam and make the roll next to the Imam, like other aspects of the Salat, you do as much as you can, and the thing that you cannot do, you're not held responsible for. So in this case, you have no way to join the line. You're supposed to join the line. There's no question that if you come and there's room in the line and you pray by yourself in the back, this is what the hadith is telling you. There's no question about that. That if there's room in the line and you pray, all the scholars agree that this is the kind of thing that the hadith is talking about. There's room in the line and you pray by yourself in the back, this is not so. However, if the line is full, then you don't have the ability to fulfill the condition of either joining the line or having someone with you in the line. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَا يُكَلِّفُ اللَّهُ نَفْسًا إِلَّا وُسْعَهَا, meaning that Allah does not bear burden any soul beyond what it can bear. So in that case, you do what you can do. The only thing you can do is you cannot join the line, and you obviously the prayer takes precedence over being in line with someone else. Okay? Then you pray by yourself in that line. If someone comes and joins you, that's fine. If someone doesn't join you, that's fine.
What can happen?
The problem with tapping, first of all, there's no evidence for doing that. There's evidence, as I said, in the verse of Laika Lizallahu Nafsani Lawtaha, for not doing it. And then when you do that, then you also disrupt the first line. You'll either make a gap in the first line or you'll make everybody move, and then there'll be an opening. And that gap is also supposed to be full because the first line is supposed to be filled first, as described in Hadith. So that means that you should pull someone back and then take his place in the line, maybe, to fulfill both. So there's some problems with that other opinion. This opinion at least has the support of that Quran group.
How these imams, they'll use different in many cases from each other. But still a lot of people do insist to follow them instead of following the Sunnah of the Prophet, which is the direct source. But they do so, and a lot of them, they say, if you don't follow an imam, then you're not a Muslim.
If you don't follow an imam, you're not a Muslim.
You're not a Muslim. They mean Imam Malik.
For the sisters, that was not my statement, I was just repeating.
They usually have this sort of thing for here a lot.
Well, as I said in the Quran,
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu atti'u Allah wa atti'u Rasul. And in many places we have to, the obedience is to Allah and His Messenger. But the Prophet said that there's no obedience to the Creator, to the created, if it involves disobedience to the Creator. So there's nothing we can see in the Quran or in the Hadith that points to the fact that you have to have an imam and follow some imam besides the imam of the Prophet Muhammad. I mean, there's no evidence for that. If someone's going to make a statement like, I mean, the way you said it is between Islam and Kufr. Either you have imam or you're not a Muslim. That means there should be some pretty clear evidence about that. And verses, not just one verse, maybe verses of Quran. Many hadiths about it. So the burden of proof for something like that is upon the one who said that. And I don't believe we can offer any proof for that.
There are no proofs, because our question is, I mean, who were they following? The imam. They were following Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Well, regardless of the, I mean, you don't even have to bring the imam into the picture. The question is, if we are obliged to follow any imam, regardless of who they might be talking about in particular, and if we don't do it, we're not a Muslim. Obviously, this is something that must be proven from the Quran and Sunnah. You cannot make such a statement. I mean, to speak about Allah Subhanahu wa Taala and His Deen without Him, this is the greatest sin, or one of the greatest sins that you could commit. So, I mean, this kind of statement, as I said, he has to bring some strong proof in the Quran.
So, and you justified the position of Lakumun, which wants to leave out Lakum Madhagon, which is a force of Imam, and let go, and let without that. But then, what about the position of the people which are following the Imam, then? And that they're doing something wrong?
Yeah. And the one who does not have the ability to study different fiqh opinions, then he has to follow the source. Yeah. I mean, even those many people nowadays who are talking about, no, we don't follow any imam at all, and we don't believe in this taqlid, they don't have ilm, they're following source. They're following some scholar. I mean, probably even some scholar told them that. Right? And even scholars themselves, sometimes they have to make taqlid. If you have a hadith and you don't have the isnad of it, and you don't have the book that wherein it's found and so forth, and you don't have the ability, for example, you're not a muhaddith, you're going to have to turn to the scholars of hadith and see what do they say about it. However, the intention always, and this is some of the things that I would have mentioned at the end of the talk had this been a complete talk, as the brother referred to. The point is, the intention has to be to follow the truth. If someone doesn't have that intention, then he is a sinner, and this is a sin, to have the intention not to follow the truth. In other words, the truth comes to you, and it is shown to you, and it is clear to you, and you still reject it and insist on following something other than that. You are a sinner without any question. This is something agreed upon by all of the souls. And if you are shown the truth, and you can understand it and see that that's the truth, but you insist on following something else, and you don't have any evidence for the thing that you're following, this is a sin. So following an imam or following a scholar, I mean, for example, if you don't know something, you have to turn. You have to ask the scholars if you don't know something. Okay? But if you ask a scholar and he gives you evidence and he shows you that what he's saying is true, and you have no evidence to the contrary, you just heard some opinion or some statement from someone, then you have no right to reject what he said and follow what he wants. But to follow an imam, or to follow scholar's opinion, there's nothing wrong with that. As long as you have the intention to follow the truth, you're following him not because of who he is, but because you have the intention to follow the truth, and any time you see the truth, as these imams said, then you will follow the truth. I mean, a true muqallid of either Abu Hanifa or Imam Malik or Shafi or Ahmed, a true muqallid who follows their statements should also follow their statement. Many of them said something like, if there's a hadith which is sahih, then it's my madhhab. Why do you follow them in everything except that one? Doesn't make any sense.
One question. What the brother was saying, there is most majority of people in India, Pakistan, Bareilly Akaid, from Bareilly, Akita, and then they trace their lineage back to Peer Abdul Qadir Jilani, or just find them, they talk that we are mainly Hanafi, India, Pakistan, this majority, we are Hanafi.
Mm-hmm.
And also they are influenced by the Shia Akaid. All the Shias, they have like Imams, and part of their belief is in believing in Imams, so many people, some group of Shia. So part of their belief, which we in our group called a shirk, you know, the part in shirk in the sense of invoking the imam, they go to every single thing through the imam, which difference between Shia between other Sunni Muslims, which the ulama can explain. Ordinary people like us living in this town, Bradford, or coming to our mosque, a Bareilly will try to get us down, a shirk who's committing a shirk, who's going worshipping grave or sitting in a mosque or doing all his crazy things. He uses one of the clever methods to get us down. His, which imam do you believe in? Even then, if you don't say, so you know, you don't believe in any imam. You're other, you're LNGs, or you are this, that, or you're doing jihad, you don't believe in any imam, you believe in yourself, astaghfirullah. You see, he will try to get you down in that way that you don't believe in imam. Very simple, you say, I confirm all imam existed, I believe in the hadith, there were four Khulafa'i Rashidin, you don't believe the four Khulafa'i Rashidin existed, the prophet existed, four Imam existed, Islam, basic history of Islam, you know, you see, I confirm that, of course there were four Imams, but you and me, we are practicing Quran and hadith, and in our everyday Islam, what we are playing, how are we? We are not invoking the Imam. Asking, are you invoking your imam? Invoking imam is that he's putting his imam, that he's going through the imam. You see, that's what the Shia says, that the imam becomes important. Because he doesn't ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly like you and me, we are asking Allah directly. And using the sunnah or the way the Prophet peace be upon him. What they try to put, give fatwa on us, you see these people who do wrong things. Oh, they have no imam. Of course we believe in that four Imam existed. We don't believe in Mawiyah existed. We don't believe in Imam Hussain.
Okay, the first question here says most Muslims pray differently, and some argue that Imam Abu Hanifa met the Sahaba and they prayed like him, and if Abu Hanifa was praying differently, the Sahaba would have corrected him. Is this true? First of all, Abu Hanifa did not meet any of the Sahaba. He's not considered one of the Tabi'een. So that. Therefore, the assumption that the Sahaba would have corrected him is not correct. But actually, we have an even bigger problem, probably, and this applies to the Hanafi Madhab as it applies to the other Madhab. If you read the books of fiqh from the different Madhab, and I mean the standard books, there are, in each Madhab, there are some standard books, you know, like Al-Mumni from the Hanbalis and Majmu'ah. From the Shafi'is and Fakhr al-Qadir and Sarafi's book. I don't remember the name of it. The big book. But I don't remember the name of it. As an item, it's just. Anyway, if you read those books, the thing that you come up with a lot, and I've experienced this a lot because I like to read stuff and I like to read different madhab because I believe the truth is in there, in the different madhab. And inshallah we will find the truth if we look and we're sincere in our look. But what I found a lot is that the thing that people claim, oh, this is the Hanafi madhab. We do this because this is the Hanafi madhab. We do this because this is the Shafi madhab and so forth. We actually studied the madhab many times. That thing that they're claiming has nothing to do whatsoever with the Hanafi madhab. Imam Abu Hanifa himself, or Imam Muhammad, or Imam Abu Yusuf, sometimes had opinions completely opposite to what they're claiming. Yes, they claim this is the Hanafi madhab.
So this is an even bigger problem. And I advise people that if you're going to follow any madhab, whether it's the Hanafi or Shafi or madhab, whatever, I think follow it correctly if you want. Because if you're going to insist on following it, then follow it correctly, because if you follow it correctly, these are great stories, and you will be much, inshallah, closer to the correct way. What do you do if a scholar makes a fatwa which goes against the consensus? Do we accept it? Well, if the question is asked in particular by consensus here means ijma, obviously if a scholar goes against an opinion in which there is ijma, and ijma means either all of the ummah agreed upon something or all of the ulama agreed upon something, in either case is the same, because if the ulama agreed upon something, it is obligatory on the rest of the ummah to follow them. So the both definitions actually are the same. There's a big discussion also in just books about whether it's all the ulama or the whole ummah. Well, the ummah is required to follow the ulama, so the result is the same. If there is a confirmed ijma, and it is a true ijma, there's no question about it, especially those dating from the early years in which really the only true ijma exists, then if someone gives a fatwa that goes against that ijma, it is rejected. Ijma is the third source in the Sulta. The majority of Muslims lack knowledge and many are illiterate. How would you advise them to seek knowledge and improve their Islam? Alhamdulillah, nowadays, even if someone is illiterate, I would advise them actually to learn how to read. I mean, I don't think it's that difficult to learn how to read, inshallah. You can, maybe your other brothers here in the mosque or sisters can help you. Because really, when you learn how to read, and I hate to, you know, give a cliche, they have these advertisements sometimes in the States, and all about learning how to read, you open up new worlds and things like that. But really, it's true. I mean, when you learn how to read, you're not just confined to the people that you know and so forth, but, you know, you can read. You know, like I've never met Ibn Taymiyyah, or I've never met Abu Hanifa, and I've never met Sirafi, but I can read their works. So it really is very beneficial. So if a person has the ability, I advise them to do that. However, nowadays, alhamdulillah, as you can see, reading isn't the only way. Attending the mosque, being with good brothers who you can learn from. You know, some people, when you're around them, you can be around them for hours and you get no benefit from them. Some of them, you're around them for a few minutes and you get lots of harm. Some of them, you're around them either for a few minutes or a long time and you get lots of benefit from them. These are the people that you should try to seek out and spend time with them so you can always benefit. Or, and also you turn to the tapes, you come to the lectures in the mosque and so forth. So even if you are illiterate, inshallah, there's many ways that you can get knowledge. Or we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase all of our knowledge and our taqwa and to be among those inhabitants of Jannah.